Without objection.
Mr. President, as we all know, we're on the Farm Bill this week in the Senate. I want to express my gratitude to Chairman Roberts and Ranking Member Stabenow for bringing us this far. Interestingly, in a town where differences tend to be along partisan lines and ideological lines, the differences in the Farm Bill tend to be largely regional as much as anything else, but they've done a good job trying to bring a fair and equitable bill to the Senate floor, and that's reflected by the near unanimous vote of the bill for the bill in the committee. The Farm Bill has always been important. Renewed every 5 years, it helps ensure that Americans and the people who benefit from American exports around the world enjoy access to the safest, cheapest, most reliable food source on the planet. The Farm Bill impacts many areas beyond food production. It promotes conservation of farmland and watersheds. Foreign food aid programs are reauthorized as part of this bill, and we lay down the policy that affects the management of our nation's forests. I'm especially pleased with this year's Farm Bill and its impact on my home state and the presiding officer's home state of Texas. Among the most noteworthy provisions is protecting seed cotton eligibility for the Farm Bill safety net. This year's bill also retains and strengthens the price loss coverage program to help provide Texas agricultural producers with stability through unpredictable weather and natural disasters. Finally, the bill promotes animal health and reauthorizes disease research programs, including a crucial one that will help the U.S. Department of Agriculture provide research and contain the spread of the cattle fever tick. I doubt many people have heard of the cattle fever tick, but it is a real threat to our herds, our beef herds, and it has the potential to wipe out cattle herds and cause devastating financial losses. I want to highlight three areas where I do think the bill could stand some improvement. First, concerning the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. There's a lot of good done in the bill for farm and agricultural programs, but many people don't know that about 80% of the money spent in the Farm Bill is directed to so-called nutrition programs. So calling this the Farm Bill is a little bit of a misnomer, since it only affects about 20%. The bill only affects deals with the farm country with about 20% of its resources. So we need to consider targeted ways of ensuring that tax dollars used to pay for these nutrition programs are used wisely. And that's why we'll support an amendment that expands work requirements for those who receive SNAP benefits. It's not just work, but it's people who are able-bodied, who need to train for work, or provide community service as a condition of qualifying for this welfare benefit. My second and related amendment will authorize a pilot program to encourage non-governmental partners to help address food insecurity in local communities. While I salute Chairman Roberts and Ranking Member Stabenow for attempting to ensure the integrity of our nutrition programs, I believe these amendments will further promote the goal which we all share. The last one I will co-sponsor with the junior senator from Kansas, whose leadership I'd like to commend, is one that addresses the wildfires we've had the last 2 years and the destruction these natural disasters have provided in farm country. I see the chairman of the Agriculture Committee on the floor, and I would yield to him if he has a question he'd like to ask.
Just a comment and to thank you for your general support for the Farm Bill. The issues that you've mentioned are very important. And we have, in the nutrition title, addressed efficiencies that you have mentioned. We have 10 states now that have pilot projects on job training to figure out in each region what really works best. The law currently allows states to have a job training and a work requirement. Kansas has that law. I'm sure Texas probably has the law. I think that we've achieved about as much as we can to at least determine, you know, where we're going. The House bill, with all due respect, has $8 billion in cuts, And then there are questions as to how that is implemented. What agency does that? Agriculture, I don't think, is prepared to really launch into a full program of job training. And the one thing that you specifically mentioned that really caused me to come down here and interrupt a great speech is that we do have that private part to supplement the federal situation in the food stamp program. So I don't know if we've hit all three that you mentioned of concerns, but we're pretty darn close. And I appreciate the gentleman's interest, and we're just trying to get a program that has better integrity, that works better, it's more efficient. We, by the way, deal with that bonus program where some states, actually only eight states, were not guilty of this, but a lot of states game the system, and we've taken care of that. We've taken a hard look at the nutrition program, but we don't declare the farm program to be a welfare program to try to put it in that kind of a description. So basically, I'm just saying with the three things that you mentioned, we've tried to address all three. Now, perhaps not to the to the degree that the distinguished senator would like to do, but that's still up for consideration. And I appreciate his comments.
Mr. President, I appreciate the chairman of the Agriculture Committee's comments, and I appreciate his efforts to try to accommodate the concerns that I've raised. And believe me, I understand this isn't his first rodeo. He's been down this path many times trying to come up with a farm bill that can get past both houses of the Congress and signed by the President of the United States, and that's no easy task. I would just say on the work requirement for qualifying for the so-called nutrition programs, I'm aware that since these are federal dollars, many states, even though they have the authority to impose some work requirement, community service, tend to waive that rather easily. Since they're not spending their money, they're spending the federal government's money. So we're looking for ways to perhaps to strengthen that provision. I hope we'll have an opportunity to have a vote on it. My goal is to make sure we pass a farm bill, but I do think it's important that we demonstrate our commitment to protecting the federal taxpayer and imposing modest work, preparation for work, or community service requirements on able-bodied people. I'd yield to the chairman.
I thank the senator for yielding. We are looking at the waivers. And we are looking at making sure that able-bodied people do achieve the goal of going from dependence to independence. It's job training to enable them to move forward, more especially in this time of economic recovery, which is really the secret to all of this. The numbers in the food stamp program have decreased dramatically as we have seen our economy improve. But on those waivers, we are taking a look at the waivers. The difference is in that the House bill, you have a situation where if somebody has children 6 and under, it used to be 10 and under, and then on the other side, people who are 50 to 60 are now included. That has raised some dust. And then in addition, there are several other things that you have mentioned. It's just a matter of degree. We want to provide integrity to that program. We want it to work and have it go to the people who truly need it. And so we tried very hard to accomplish that. We will study hard the good recommendations that you have mentioned, and we'll do our best.
I appreciate the chairman's comments, and I have confidence in him and his ability to manage this bill successfully across the floor. Mr. President, I yield the floor, and I note the absence of a quorum.
The clerk will call the roll.